try to control myself. I really want to gush about what an awesome talk that was, what a role model you are. I mean, speaking about this so clearly and putting out a tool that can really help public health in such a broad way, it's really inspiring. So thank you, and I use your...
Thank you. I'll because, continue. But
yeah. And Ahmed recommended that we start using this in a course that I teach this, and we love it. So, or I do anyway, the students.
It can be painful at times. I've been through six of them, so yeah, I can tell you.
But I have noticed that, you know, because of where you come from, you know, the language is sort of wrapped around chemical exposures. But this is a tool that can be used for injury or infection or other outcomes. And I wonder if you have any plans to do any, you know, model studies where you actually do something on infection or injury.
It's probably not likely in our research group, just because that's not really where our focus lies. Mm-hmm. We are very heavily steeped in environmental chemicals, and so that's kind of where we apply the framework. But I do know of others who are in more clinical sciences, medical fields, who might be interested in that. And I do know that, for instance, the National Toxicology Program is looking at assessing chemicals, and they're actually focusing a lot on kind of the Tox21 kind of newer data sets that have been coming out in vitro studies, and looking at kind of screening those. Again, that's more kind of focused on environmental chemicals and pesticides. But there's definitely a broad application that this framework and similar frameworks can be applied to.
Can you just say a few words about some of the efforts you guys are doing in terms of training federal scientists and like at Cal EPA support to actually use this tool and to scale it, because it is so time intensive?
Yes. So after doing 6 case studies, we decided that it's probably not in the cards for us to do another one. It's very time and energy and resource intensive. What we've decided to focus our efforts on is training other people to be able to use these approaches. And so we have a 3-year grant right now to be developing training materials that we're currently working on, and we're trying to make everything free and openly available and on the web. And what it will do is kind of target different audiences. So obviously not everyone wants to do a full-blown systematic review, but people might be interested in systematic review because they're reviewing a peer review manuscript, and it's a systematic review paper, and they might not have expertise with systematic review, but they want to know what to look for in a systematic review. So we'll have some training materials that kind of give a high-level overview of this is what you want to see in a good systematic review. That can also help journal editors as well as they're deciding what papers to decide to publish or to send to peer review. And then we'll have kind of a more deeper dive for people at EPA, the federal EPA or Cal EPA, who are doing systematic review, who want to learn about the different steps. And so there'll be a deeper dive into each of those steps that I was talking about very briefly today. And then something that might be relevant for students as well is not everyone wants to go through the whole systematic review, but you might want to know how to do a systematic literature search really well. And so you'll have one, you know, module that focuses on that, where you can just go in, learn about that, and then be able to do one piece of the systematic review. So we're trying to develop those materials over the next year or two, and we're hoping to have those published pretty soon online. Yeah.
Well, thanks for coming. It sounds like you have a very full day at GW.
She's going to be teaching later in EOFE, so, yeah.
But I really enjoyed this. It touched on so many things that I think are of interest to our students. I did have a specific question with respect to when you're actually doing the literature review and you're selecting the papers. I know you start with the Eskenazi paper, and you showed all the papers that have been selected. One thing I notice that comes up especially when our students are doing this, or if I'm reviewing papers to sort of review something, is that you can have one study and they have 3 papers on the same thing. Mm-hmm. And so do you count their most recent paper, or do you count them again? Because sometimes it's like we extended the follow-up, and here's what we found.
Yeah.
And so I wouldn't want to count, it seems to me like if you count them all 3 papers, mm-hmm. you're sort of inducing a bias mm-hmm. in your review.
Yeah. So those multiple studies are included in kind of the overall count of studies. So Eskenazi's got like a million different papers. So on the same cohort. Mm-hmm. So when we're looking at that cohort, we are usually capturing them in the 2,540 number. When we get down to the 15 studies, What we usually do is we identify which cohorts have multiple publications, and we identify the most relevant paper. So oftentimes it's the most recent paper because it's the one where the children have been followed up for the longest period of time. But sometimes it's not, because sometimes they'll follow up the children and then extend that to look at a different health outcome, or a health outcome that might not be preferable to be including. So for instance, for IQ, there's a big difference when you're looking at IQ of 4-year-olds versus 8-year-olds. So for some of the studies, they had newer updated studies, but we decided to keep it in the same realm of the age group of the existing, of the included studies that we had. So we only select one paper, but we have, and we actually outline this in our protocol, the justifications for why we select the most relevant study. So there is only one included. We do technically include all the rest, so we don't throw any of the papers out. We kind of append them on as supplemental to the actual paper that we end up using, because oftentimes it can have additional information as well that's useful for evaluating the quality of that study. So sometimes they'll say in the biomonitoring approaches that they use to measure PBDs, they'll say, you know, as in Eskenazi 2011, we did the same approach. So you have to kind of go back to that paper and find that piece of information that they didn't publish in the newer one. So it's kind of this whole process, and pretty complicated in terms of keeping all your sources of information together. Yeah.
Thanks, I enjoyed it very much. What do you do? I know you had a case study featuring epi studies, but what do you do for tox studies? Do you apply the same criteria, or what's your approach there?
Yeah, that's a great question, because it's similar. It's similar in terms of the steps, but everything's completely different because now it's geared towards animal tox studies. So we have a PICO statement, but obviously it's going to look a lot different than the human epi studies. We still do the systematic search, but we'll have search terms that are specifically geared towards animal studies. And then when we're rating the quality and the strength of the evidence, some of those criteria are the same, but some are different, and we have some new ones. So for instance, study population selection. That's not something that's relevant to animal studies, but we have randomization, which is relevant to animal studies, but not to human epi studies.
So you'll keep those separate.
We have it.
You won't do it. You won't do a systematic review with both epi and tox together.
We do them together, but we do each evidence stream differently.
Okay.
So we have one stream where we do the human data, and then usually when I'm showing the case study where we do both, there'll be an animal data and kind of a similar line, but they're done separately, and then they're integrated at the very end, where you integrate both pieces of evidence to say collectively, based on the human and the animal evidence, what does this say about human effects.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Hi, great talk. I'm curious especially about your leap, great that you're on the slide right now, between the rating the different manuscripts or articles and then the overall conclusion, because you seem to have a very distinct numerical conclusion. And when we work with students, we find it difficult to go there. A lot of times, you know, 10 studies say this and 4 studies say this. There's conflict sometimes, or a lot of times in the studies. So how did you come up with that 3.7 per tenfold increase? Was that an average or kind of a weighted average based on?
So the 3.7, the meta-analysis, this is only one kind of piece of rating the overall evidence. So we only had 4 studies that we deemed combinable. So we combined those in a random effects model. So it's basically a weighted meta-analysis that weights each study based on the, we actually inverse weighted based on the sample size. So larger studies are weighted more heavily than smaller studies. So we have an overall effect, and that's the effect that gets reported the most often because it's really simple. It's like one estimate that combines results from several studies. But we had more than 4 studies, so we also look at visually plotting all of the other results or putting them in a table, and we consider all of the evidence. So that's a hard thing for to get across oftentimes because people gravitate towards this, but it was more than this that played into our final decision. But oftentimes you kind of do see like 10 studies say this, and then you always have 1 or 2 studies that say something completely different. So a lot of what we do is look at evaluating different study designs or characteristics to see if you can explain those differences. So sometimes the population might be different, or the exposure levels might have been a little bit lower in those studies than others. And if you can kind of explain that, that helps you kind of integrate all of the evidence and evaluate it collectively. But that's the most challenging piece of it. The benefit to systematic review is it forces you to explain how you came to that conclusion. And so somebody who might disagree with you, saying, oh, that one study that was showing negative effects, I really think that that's a high quality study, and that should have driven your overall effect estimate, or your overall conclusion, that can be something that they disagree with you on. So that's, again, where scientific judgment comes into play, and there's really no avoiding that. But it forces you to be transparent about it.
Yeah, actually, that was a great segue, and I'm glad you're on this slide, because I want to ask about different exposure levels.
Uh-huh.
So sometimes, and you said here in this case, you had a thousandfold change in some of the studies. So how do you handle that when some exposure response relationships may be nonlinear? Sometimes there could be some sort of population threshold.
Mm-hmm.
Would you combine that all into one estimate, or can you?
So that's one of the ways that we selected these four studies. So these four studies were all looking at exposure ranges that were pretty similar. They all were approaching this and actually using the same kind of log transformed. Logistic regression model reporting odds ratios. So they all kind of saw the same relation, kind of a similar relationship in the data, and were able to use the same model to be reporting these effect estimates. And so we wanted to select studies that kind of did that similarly. So if we have another study that was looking at a different statistical model, you might not want to combine that in with these studies. So that's kind of one of the rationale for why we only selected these four studies out of the total number of IQ studies.
That seems like a potential source of bias, doesn't it? If you're sort of choosing them for ease of combining rather than necessarily for the appropriateness of the analytic.
Well, part of it is ease, but part of it is because it makes sense biologically to be able to combine things with similar models. But if you have an effect estimate that's being reported that's not necessarily using the same model, for instance, if they didn't log transform, you wouldn't want to just throw that out. So what we actually do, which I didn't talk about here, is we went back to all of the study authors and we asked them, if you still have the data, are you able to transform it in this way and get us the results? So it does introduce some bias, but we try to get around that as best as possible. Oftentimes we don't hear from them.
All the ones that you dropped off, yeah.
Yeah, we either don't hear from them, they don't have the data, but some of them did. One of them actually did redo their analysis in a way so that we could combine it into the study.
I'm familiar with this body of literature, and I mean, didn't Ersteman look at cord blood, whereas the other ones looked at maternal blood? Was that an issue?
I know we contacted Julie Ersteman to get additional data from her. That might have been something that was in her supplemental materials, or that we were able to get from her. They're all in maternal
serum.
They
were.
Yeah. So maternal serum and cord blood, we made the decision not to combine them, but we did do a secondary analysis where we did combine them all, but we decided the peer reviewers didn't like that, so they didn't want us to include it in. But it didn't really, it only added like a few additional studies, and it didn't really change the effect estimate that much. But we did look at combining them.
So just to follow up on that, this is something close to my heart because I work on air pollution, and so what happens at the very low end and what happens at the very high end are the biggest sources of uncertainty right now. And, you know, we're seeing things play out in real time, like in the recent regulatory impact analysis for the repeal of the Clean Power Plan. They did not quantify health benefits below the current National Ambient Air Quality Standard. So would you qualify the result of your review and say that it applies only to a certain exposure range?
Yes, yeah, and we report that exposure range anytime we report the effect estimate.
I try to control myself. I really want to gush about what an awesome talk that was, what a role model you are. I mean, speaking about this so clearly and putting out a tool that can really help public health in such a broad way, it's really inspiring. So. Thank you, and I use your...
Thank you, I can continue, but...
Ahmed recommended that we start using this in a course that I teach this, and we love it. So, or I do anyway, the students don't.
It can be painful at times. I've been through six of them,
But I have noticed that, you know, because of where you come from, you know, the language is sort of wrapped around chemical exposures, but this is a tool that can be used for injury or infection or other outcomes, and I wonder if you have any plans to do any, you know, model studies where you actually do something on infection or injury.
It's probably not likely in our research group, just because that's not really where our focus lies.
Mm-hmm.
We are very heavily steeped in environmental chemicals, and so that's kind of where we apply the framework. But I do know of others who are in more clinical sciences, medical fields, who might be interested in that. And I do know that, for instance, the National Toxicology Program is looking at assessing chemicals, and they're actually focusing a lot on kind of the Tox-21 kind of newer data sets that have been coming out in vitro studies, and looking at kind of screening those. Again, that's more kind of focused on environmental chemicals and pesticides. But there's definitely a broad application that this framework and similar frameworks can be applied to.
Can you just say a few words about some of the efforts you guys are doing in terms of training federal scientists and like at Cal EPA
yeah.
so forth to actually use this tool and to scale it because it
yeah.
is so time intensive?
Yes. So after doing 6 case studies, we decided that it's probably not in the cards for us to do another one. It's very time and energy and resource intensive. What we've decided to focus our efforts on is training other people to be able to use these approaches. And so we have a 3-year grant right now to be developing training materials that we're currently working on, and we're trying to make everything free and openly available and on the web. And what it will do is kind of target different audiences. So obviously not everyone wants to do a full-blown systematic review, but people might be interested in systematic review because they're reviewing a peer review manuscript, and it's a systematic review paper, and they might not have expertise with systematic review, but they want to know what to look for in a systematic review. So we'll have some training materials that kind of give a high-level overview of this is what you want to see in a good systematic review. That can also help journal editors as well as they're deciding what papers to decide to publish or to send to peer review. And then we'll have kind of a more deeper dive for people at EPA, the federal EPA or Cal EPA who are doing systematic review, who want to learn about the different steps. And so there'll be a deeper dive into each of those steps that I was talking about very briefly today. And then something that might be relevant for students as well is not everyone wants to go through the whole systematic review, but you might want to know how to do a systematic literature search really well. And so you'll have one module that focuses on that where you can just go in, learn about that, and then be able to do one piece of the systematic review. So we're trying to develop those materials over the next year or two, and we're hoping to have those published pretty soon online. Yeah.
Well, thanks for coming. It sounds like you have a very full day at GW.
She's going to be teaching later in EOEPI, so yeah.
But I really enjoyed this. It touched on so many things that I think are of interest to our students. I did have a specific question with respect to when you're actually doing the literature review and you're selecting the papers. I know it started with the Eskenazi paper, and you showed the all the papers that have been selected. One thing I notice that comes up when, especially when our students are doing this, or if I'm reviewing papers to sort of review something, is that you can have one study and they have 3 papers on the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
And so do you count their most recent paper, or you count them again? Because sometimes it's like, we extended the follow-up,
yeah.
and here's what we found. And so I wouldn't want to count, it seems to me like if you count them all 3 papers,
mm-hmm.
you're sort of inducing a bias
mm-hmm.
in your review.
Yeah. So those multiple studies are included in kind of the overall count of studies. So Eskenazi's got like a million different papers. So on the same cohort.
Mm-hmm.
So when we're looking at that cohort, we are usually capturing them in the 2,540 number. When we get down to the 15 studies, what we usually do is we identify which cohorts have multiple publications, and we identify the most relevant paper. So oftentimes it's the most recent paper because it's the one where the children have been followed up for the longest period of time. But sometimes it's not, because sometimes they'll follow up the children and then extend that to look at a different health outcome, or a health outcome that might not be preferable to be including. So for instance, for IQ, there's a big difference when you're looking at IQ of 4-year-olds versus 8-year-olds. So for some of the studies, they had newer updated studies, but we decided to keep it in the same realm of the age group of the existing, of the included studies that we had. So we only select one paper, but we have, and we actually outline this in our protocol, the justifications for why we select the most relevant study. So there is only one included. we do technically include all the rest, so we don't throw any of the papers out. We kind of append them on as supplemental to the actual paper that we end up using, because oftentimes it can have additional information as well that's useful for evaluating the quality of that study. So sometimes they'll say in the biomonitoring approaches that they use to measure PBDs, they'll say, you know, as in Eskenazi 2011, we did the same approach. So you have to kind of go back to that paper and find that piece of information that they didn't publish in the newer one. So it's kind of this whole process and pretty complicated in terms of keeping all your sources of information together. Yeah.
Thanks, I enjoyed it very much. What do you do? I know you had a case study featuring epi studies, but what do you do for tox studies? Do you apply the same criteria or what's your approach there?
Yeah, that's a great question because it's similar. It's similar in terms of the steps, but everything's completely different because now it's geared towards animal tox studies. So we have a PICO statement, but obviously it's going to look a lot different than the human epi studies. We still do the systematic search, but we'll have search terms that are specifically geared towards animal studies. And then when we're rating the quality and the strength of the evidence, some of those criteria are the same, but some are different, and we have some new ones. So for instance, study population selection. That's not something that's relevant to animal studies, but we have randomization, which is relevant to animal studies, but not to human epi studies.
But
so
you'll keep those separate.
We have it.
You won't do it. You won't do a systematic review with both epi and tox together.
We do them together, but we do each evidence stream differently.
Okay.
So we have one stream where we do the human data, and then usually when I'm showing the case study where we do both,
mm-hmm.
there'll be an animal data and kind of a similar line, but they're done separately,
mm-hmm.
and then they're integrated at the very end, where you integrate both pieces of evidence to say collectively, based on the human and the animal evidence, what does this say about human effects.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Hi. Yeah. Great talk. I'm curious, especially about your leap. Great that you're on the slide right now. Between the rating the different manuscripts or articles, and then the overall conclusion, because you seem to have a very distinct numerical conclusion. And when we work with students, we find it difficult to go there. A lot of times, you know, 10 studies say this and 4 studies say this. There's conflict sometimes, or
yeah.
a lot of times in the studies. So how did you come up with that 3.7 per tenfold increase? Was that an average or kind of a weighted average based on?
So the 3.7, the meta-analysis, this is only one kind of piece of rating the overall evidence. So we only had 4 studies that we deemed combinable. So we combined those in a random effects model. So it's basically a weighted meta-analysis that weights each study based on the, we actually inverse weighted based on sample size. So larger studies are weighted more heavily than smaller studies. So we have an overall effect, and that's the effect that gets reported the most often because it's really simple. It's like one estimate that combines results from several studies. But we had more than 4 studies, so we also look at visually plotting all of the other results or putting them in a table, and we consider all of the evidence. So that's a hard thing for to get across oftentimes because people gravitate towards this, but it was more than this that played into our final decision. But oftentimes you kind of do see like 10 studies say this, and then you always have 1 or 2 studies that say something completely different. So a lot of what we do is look at evaluating different study designs or characteristics to see if you can explain those differences. So sometimes the population might be different, or the exposure levels might have been a little bit lower in those studies than others. And if you can kind of explain that, that helps you kind of integrate all of the evidence and evaluate it collectively. But that's the most challenging piece of it. The benefit to systematic review is it forces you to explain how you came to that conclusion. And so somebody who might disagree with you, saying, oh, that one study that was showing negative effects, I really think that that's a high quality study, and that should have driven your overall effect estimate or your overall conclusion, that can be something that they disagree with you on. So that's, again, where scientific judgment comes into play, and there's really no avoiding that. But it forces you to be transparent about it.
Actually, that was a great segue, and I'm glad you're on this slide, because I want to ask about different exposure levels. So sometimes, and you said here in this case you had 1,000-fold change in some of the studies. So how do you handle that when some exposure response relationships may be nonlinear, sometimes there could be some sort of population threshold? Would you combine that all into one estimate, or can you?
So that's one of the ways that we selected these 4 studies. So these 4 studies were all looking at exposure ranges that were pretty similar. They all were approaching this and actually using the same kind of log transformed logistic regression model reporting odds ratios. So they all kind of saw the same relation, kind of a similar relationship in the data, and were able to use the same model to be reporting these effect estimates. And so we wanted to select studies that kind of did that similarly. So if we have another study that was looking at a different statistical model, you might not want to combine that in with these studies. So that's kind of one of the rationale for why we only selected these four studies out of the total number of IQ studies.
That seems like a potential source of bias, doesn't it? If you're sort of choosing them for ease of combining rather than necessarily for the appropriateness of the analytic.
Well, part of it is ease, but part of it is because it makes sense biologically to be able to combine things with similar models. But if you have an effect estimate that's being reported that's not necessarily using the same model, for instance, if they didn't log transform, you wouldn't want to just throw that out. So what we actually do, which I didn't talk about here, is we went back to all of the study authors and we asked them, if you still have the data, are you able to transform it in this way and get us the results? So it does introduce some bias, but we try to get around that as best as possible. Oftentimes we don't hear from them.
All those other ones that you dropped off, yeah.
Yeah, we either don't hear from them, they don't have the data, but some of them did. One of them actually did redo their analysis in a way so that we could combine it into the study. So
I'm familiar with this body of literature, and I mean, didn't Erbstman look at cord blood, whereas the other ones looked at maternal blood? Was that an issue?
I know we contacted Julie Erbstman to get additional data from her. That might have been something that was in her supplemental materials, or that we were able to get from her.
Because
they were all in maternal. No, they're all in maternal
they
serum.
Were.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah. So maternal serum and cord blood. We made the decision not to combine them, but we did do a secondary analysis where we did combine them all. But we decided the peer reviewers didn't like that, so they didn't want us to include it in. But it didn't really. It only added like a few additional studies, and it didn't really change the effect estimate that much. But we did look at combining them.
So just to follow up on that, this is something close to my heart because I work on air pollution, and so what happens at the very low end and what happens at the very high end are the biggest sources of uncertainty right now. And you know, we're seeing things play out in real time, like in the recent regulatory impact analysis for the repeal of the Clean Power Plan. They did not quantify health benefits below the current national ambient air quality standard. So would you qualify the result of your review and say that it applies only to a certain exposure range?
Yes, yeah, and we report that exposure range anytime we report the effect estimate.